Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. On behalf of the Bali and Hollands Diep, we welcome you all to this wonderful event. We kindly request you to turn off your phones or put them on silent, at least. You can tweet, but only if you can do that in a very inconspicuous manner. This evening is wonderful because we have two highly acclaimed authors discussing a marvelous novel, and perhaps more. It is therefore my great pleasure to introduce you to Mr. Tommy Wieringa, one of the most well-known and highly appreciated Dutch authors, and Mr. Zia Haider Rahman. Mr. Rahman is the author of the bestseller In the Light of What We Know. Not too long ago, this book was translated in Dutch and was picked up by the media almost immediately thereafter, receiving praise and applause from important critics. To say that the book was well received in the Netherlands would be a bit of an understatement. On this evening, here for us, both authors will discuss this book extensively. So without further ado, please give a warm welcome to Mr. Tommy Wieringa and Mr. Zia Haider Rahman.
My first remark will be in Dutch. Toen ik hier vorige week belde de man die ons zojuist zo aardig introduceerde. En die zei, ik wil heel graag weten hoe de avond zal verlopen. En ik zei dat de avond zou verlopen volgens vermoedelijk een vraag- en antwoordmodus. En waarschijnlijk een begin, een midden en een eind zou kennen. En ik heb echt geprobeerd om er iets anders van te maken. Maar dit is gewoon het meest effectieve model voor het interview. May you live in interesting times, says an old Chinese proverb, or Winston Churchill, you never know who. And this novel is attributed to some, this novel is a fictional account of the most interesting times we live in. It's been a dazzling experience reading In the Light of What We Know. The narrative structure is complex and the story is full of promise, and the reader can never be sure how many promises are fulfilled in the end. The story is told by a nameless narrator who, on a certain day, opens his front door to welcome a long-lost friend, Zafar, who mentions just a name, the name of a famous and dead mathematician called Gödel. That's the only word he says, Gödel. And the visitor is his guest for a while, they're old friends, and tells the nameless narrator his life story, which becomes In the Light of What We Know. This is the English version, and I ripped off the paper cloth, and this is the Dutch version, which you can buy later on, and I would...
This is the English paperback version. That was the hardback version.
It reminds one of Moby Dick and W.G. Sebald's The Emigres. Others mentioned Brideshead Revisited, The Great Gatsby and Austerlitz, among many other titles, comparisons in the light of what we know, indeed. To me, it seemed almost a Talmudic novel, piling up one intelligent comment after another, a 19th century-like novel with momentous titles and subtitles, footnotes and endless digressions, a novel about, I quote, the breaking of nations, war in the 21st century, marriage into the English aristocracy, and the mathematics of love. Zia, welcome.
Thank you.
To start off with this mathematician, I of course had never heard about him, Kurt Gödel. I looked him up on the internet. He was called Herr Warum when he grew up in Brno, in Moravia, what is now Slovakia. Because he always asked why, and he became a famous famous mathematician who's most famous for the Gödel's incompleteness theorem. You said about the theorem, you sort of summarized it, within any given system there are claims which are true but which cannot be proven to be true. So states the theorem. And the book sort of begins and ends with Gödel. And can you explain the importance of this theorem to us, to our inexperienced ears?
Sure, yeah. Well, first of all, can I say, I'm not sure I can say it, but I'm going to try. Welcome and dank für Ukunft.
Yes.
Apparently, I sound like Mick Jagger.
No, but Dutch is like farting. I mean, you can, everyone can do it.
It's a great question. The theorem, you know, someone once said that the three greatest discoveries of the 20th century were Einstein's theory of relativity, Watson and Crick's elaboration of the structure of DNA, and Kurt Gödel's incompleteness theorem. But the reason we don't hear so much about the last one is that it only concerns the nature of truth, and who cares about that? The theorem states very simply, it's a very unusual theorem because you can actually state it in plain language. Mm-hmm. By the way, I apologize, my English is, I tend to speak very quickly. It is shocking to me that I don't speak Dutch. I don't mean that facetiously, because the Dutch speak English fluently. It's extraordinary. So I apologize. I genuinely, sincerely apologize that you have to come down to my level. The theorem states that there are claims that are true, mathematical claims, that are true but cannot be proven to be true. Now, anybody who did a bit of high school mathematics will see that this is quite an odd thing, because the way we find out whether something is true is to prove that it's true. Mm-hmm. Or at least that was the experience we had when we were in school, right? You prove, to show that Pythagoras' theorem is true, you need a proof, and then that proof tells you that it's true. Well, Kurt Gödel came along and said, in fact, he proved that there is a difference between the two, that actually, there, in a very well-defined way, it is possible. In fact, he showed a statement, a very odd statement, but he showed a statement that is true but cannot be proven to be true. Now, it's beyond the scope of this to talk about the details of that. Mm-hmm. But the very fact, just by pondering that, considering that idea, you begin to see this, the strangeness of truth, certainly in the mathematical context, the strangeness, the sense that it is, separate from proof, and therefore you acquire a metaphor for looking at epistemology in another way as well. And this book is about that. It's about many things, but underlying throughout this book is a central question about the reliability of not just the world, but our perception of the world. And I use that Kurt Gödel theorem because, how do I use it? Well, this particular character is obsessed with that. Mm. He's obsessed with this because it, for him, mathematics was a place of certainty, of clarity. And yet along comes this theorem. And it, by the way, it was a devastating theorem when it was discovered. In fact, it was announced very casually by Kurt Gödel at a conference in Vienna. And he was in the graveyard slot, meaning right at the end of the three-day or whatever conference, at a throwaway remark he made. And nobody really understood. He's a very odd character. Nobody really caught the significance of this comment, except one person, John von Neumann, the titan, the great John von Neumann. John von Neumann is one of the greatest mathematicians of the 20th century. He was a professor at Princeton at the Institute for Advanced Study. He happened to be in Vienna. He went up to Gödel afterwards, and he buttonholed him, and he said, "Hang on, did you say what I think you said?" And Gödel said, "Well, yes. Why would I say something that I... Why would you think I wouldn't say what I said?" Yeah. He didn't say that, but that's the sort of thing that Gödel would say. And then von Neumann got Gödel over to the Institute of Advanced Study in Princeton, and that's how it came into the world. Mm. And at that time, David Hilbert, this great titan of, really the grandfather of mathematics throughout the world, had set down this program of problems that he thought should be solved, should attract all the attention of mathematicians. I'm going too much on this, I know.
No, it's lovely.
There's a context, you know, there is a context. And it shook the foundations of mathematics, because everybody believed that this could not possibly be true, what Gödel said. Before Gödel said it, everybody thought, you see, it has various implications. Everybody thought that all the mathematical truths out there could be reached. We just have to find the proofs for them. And Gödel came along and said, no, there are things that are true that we will never be able to know are true.
But this must be a very popular argument for believers, for Muslims and Christians.
Well, this is it. Well, for any religion. Yeah. Religion is pretty
good. I talk about theology a lot. Yeah. And they never came up with Gödel.
No. Well, you see, it's the mathematics. You know, mathematics is regarded as an alien province. You know, it's occupied by people who really have a different passport. You know? And occasionally they come to visit and we give them tea and then they go back. I think that's the reality of our world. We have, you know, the book explores borders, and we are trained, all of us. We grow up we are educated in a way to absorb these divisions. But the world doesn't, nature doesn't recognize these divisions, right? These are our divisions. I mean, this table doesn't give a hoot about the difference between history and engineering, or, you know, these are things that we impose on the world. In England, in the 19th century, you could only get a degree in two subjects. One was mathematics and the other was classics at Cambridge. So mathematics had a different status. And, you know, you look at the 19th century, the 18th century, the great novelists and thinkers, philosophers, they did mathematics as well. It wasn't alien in the way that it is now, and it wasn't hard. I mean, this idea of mathematics being hard is our invention as well. It's not really that hard. This is another conversation, but the problem has become that our teachers, our math teachers, frankly, are not as good as they could be. And the reason is that math graduates, they have the highest employment rate of all graduates, math graduates. So there's a real problem in maths teaching. We don't have the best teachers in mathematics. And it's very hard for people to say that. It's very unpopular. You know, I'm a liberal, I'm a left-winger, and criticizing teachers, which is what this sounds like, is verboten.
It is. It doesn't sound. Like it. It is.
But there is a systemic problem. Yeah. Anyway, this is a digression on a digression.
Yeah. This is the way he writes.
Yeah. Well. A little bit. But I do come back.
Zafar, we have to go back to Zafar because he is the main reason why mathematics plays such a big role in this novel. And Zafar reminds me of Joseph Roth, to whom displacement was a main characteristic. Yeah. Displacement is. I mean, this you could define his soul as displaced. Yeah. And there's also another thing which I was reminded of reading about him, that the Bhagavad Gita defines a human as a wound with nine openings.
A wound with nine openings.
Yes.
Wow.
So that's what I had to think of reading about Zafar, and he sort of finds solid ground. I mean, he's alienated from everything, but he finds solid ground in mathematics.
Yes.
But it's not solid enough in the end. He loses faith, and he sort of faces a total mental and physical total loss.
Yeah.
And what is it? There's a beautiful quote, by the way, which is quoted in the book. By Simone Weil, and I quote you quoting her, "To be rooted is perhaps the most important and least recognized need of the human soul." Yeah. And this Zafar finds roots into mathematics, but in the end he loses it. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah. Well, you know, part of the reason he loses it is...
Is it enough to become a whole person?
No, it's not. And, you know... In the book, the way the mathematics operates, and by the way, if you haven't read the book, I think We're overrepresenting the influence, the presence of mathematics in the book. This is a problem with language. We start at one subject, and you know that occupies a certain amount of time. You only get a sense of how much of the weight of the mathematics after we've spoken for 3 hours. So we're not going to speak for 3 hours. Don't worry.
Well,
the mathematics operates as a counterpoint to the other things in the book that are unfathomable, right? So so they are the class system. Unfathomable for Zafar, they are the things like the class system. They are British foreign policy in Iraq and Afghanistan.
We'll come to that.
Yeah, I know. No, but the point is that these are, you know, maths is a place of refuge from all those things that are so impossible, so hard for Zafar to negotiate. So that's how I see the mathematics within the scheme of the book, mm-hmm. that it acts as a, you know, mathematics has no ego. There's no ego involved in mathematics, whereas if you're writing an essay on history or literature or you're writing a review of a book, you know, what you're trying to do is manage your ego. You're trying to bring your ego in line with things like reason and judgment and all the other things. In mathematics, the ego has no venue. There's no aperture through which the ego can enter the work. It's of no relevance. And so when I use that phrase in the opening of the book, I talk about the book, the narrator says he's going to explore the mathematics of love. Mm. What he's really saying is, look, I'm going to look at love in this novel, but try and strip out ego. It's a very ugly love. He finds that the love is, you know, Zafar's love of Emily is inflected by things like class, by Zafar's desire to escape his origins, things like that.
And his origins are Bangladesh.
His origins come from a corner of the world. Exactly. Yeah. Not just Bangladesh, but very poor.
Yeah.
Very, you know. So from a literary perspective, it's a device as well. Yeah. It acts as a contraposition.
Could you consider Gödel if Zafar finds shelter in mathematics, then Gödel, you might consider him as the landlord who throws him out of the house because of his incompleteness.
I think that's right. He sort of looks at, he comes across this theorem quite a while ago. In fact, before the start of the novel, he's already come across this. And it is, and there's a passage at the end where you sort of see why it matters to him so much, you know, mathematics with... I did a radio program with the BBC, and there was a Fields medalist. The Fields medal is the equivalent of the Nobel Prize in mathematics, called Cedric Villani on the show. And Cedric Villani said that, you know, he described, we were exchanging quotes, which is inevitable on these radio programs, especially when you talk about mathematics, because, you know, it's safe territory. People are familiar with the quotes about mathematics rather than saying what you think. And Einstein said that mathematics is the queen of the sciences. Cedric Villani mentioned this. And, you know, I had made an observation about how mathematics is immune to empirical revision. Nothing we experience, nothing we taste, touch, can change a mathematical result. It's once something is proven, it is proven forever. And the host of the program had trouble with this. A little bit, not quite believing it seemed. Cedric made the observation that this is true, but there's this tiny chink, there's a tiny crack in this statement that nothing can ever be undermined by empirical revision, and that is Gödel's incompleteness theorem. It has all sorts of ramifications. It means that, I mean, I don't think you need to go into that, but it has all these ramifications. And some of these are explored in the novel. You get a sense of why this is significant. But really, it's totemic. It acts in contraposition to all these things all these fields where everybody, political pundits, have this this extraordinary certainty. They say things with huge conviction. And yet, you know, the war in Afghanistan, right? And yet, the evidence is that they're talking out of their bottoms. You know, their asses. This is complete crap. Yeah, there's a lot of evidence. Political pundits get it wrong all the time, right? There's a famous, Philip Tetlock is a professor of psychology at, used to be at University of California at Berkeley, did a famous piece of work in the, at the end of the last century. He asked several hundred political pundits, famous political pundits in the US, to give predictions, fill in a questionnaire, 250 questions. And they were questions of the kind, you know, where will GNP be in 2 years, or where will growth be, rather, and, you know, will the Palestine-Israel question be settled peaceably within 10 years, this sort of thing. And he covers a 15-year span. He asked a heck of a lot of pundits, guaranteed them anonymity. So these are well-known people. Famously, when he published his results, I think it was 2006, when he published his results, he said, if you took a monkey, and you got a monkey to throw darts at a dartboard, the monkey would do a better job. And it's true. I mean, political pundits are terrible at predicting. And prediction is part of what people, politicians do when they tell us that we should go and fight ISIS right now, because that's the way to stop them, right? Yep. There's a prediction embedded in every policy
what you say, that deeds are in the end questions.
Yeah, exactly.
And there is a question, it's always a bit of a dull question, but I kept asking it in my head, what was the initial idea for this novel? What was it that you, if you strip it of all the stories you tell, what is the because to me it was difficult. I mean, I can find a few diamonds in there, which where it circles around. But what was for you? What was the main idea? The flash of insight, or was it a slow process?
No, there wasn't a flash of insight, but there was a sense of what the whole thing was about. I think I just told you how I came to write. In 2007, I quit my job. And I went traveling. I quit my job because I was really at a loss.
You were then a banker or a lawyer?
I was a human rights lawyer, yeah. But actually I just got pulled in by the financial regulator. They headhunted me to advise on the banking crisis of just beginning in 2007, yeah. Not 2008, actually 2000. So I did that for 3 months, and then I decided to go traveling. I was at a loss. I was, I think, I've avoided saying it, but there was a moment of personal crisis. I was not sure what the hell I was doing with my life, but also what the hell everybody else was doing with their lives, you know, sort of. I was watching the TV and we were bombing everything, you know, and we seemed to think that throwing bombs was the right way to respond to what seemed to me very much more complex situation. And also, let's not forget Sykes-Picot, you know, divide up the world in this way. And then it seemed to me obvious that these problems were much more complicated than the analyses that were given, and that none of us really knew. No, I wasn't saying that I had the answers. I was saying, I don't see how you have the answers. How can you be so sure there are weapons of mass destruction? This is very bizarre. And I was despairing, and I'd had very troubling experiences as well as in human rights work, and not quite convinced about. That's another story. So I went traveling, and then I got interrupted halfway. I was in Syria, and I got interrupted by... Syria is a very different country then. And I found myself with friends who had lost a child. I was trying to be a comfort to them. There's not much you can do. I started writing something. And it was really very clear to me within 2 or 3 months what it was. So clear, in fact, that I wrote the first chapter, the next thing I wrote was the last chapter, and they are virtually unchanged. Hmm? Virtually unchanged. And in fact, it was actually about a few months later that I realized that this book was going to take a while.
Yes.
And then I thought, damn, this is going to take a while. I'm going to change during the course of writing this. This is troubling because I don't want the mood of the book to change. So then I went through the book, found places where I thought, the mood is... I'm going to have to hit that fundamental note here, here, and here. Mm. And so I wrote those scenes. And then the rest I wrote depending on my actual mood. So if I was in a really angry mood that morning, I'd find an angry scene and I'd write that and this sort of thing. So. But the idea did come to me quite quickly. I mean, But I've been writing for 20 years, and the ideas come. I say quickly.
What have you been writing then? Not novels.
Not novels. Short stories. Yeah. Things that could become novels. Here's the thing, right? I write something. It's not for publication. So for me, the proof, right, I think of it in those terms. You know, I wrote this book, and then I sold it to a publisher. And yeah, this is between you and me, but there was one big mistake in the book. There was one huge, not mistake, something that needed to be fixed. And it was really obvious to me. And I couldn't be bothered to fix it.
And that's
every mathematician knows what I'm talking about. It's not there. Every mathematician, because the moment you found the proof, you just kind of, you know, well, I know what the proof is. Why do I need to write it down? And it was simple. It was this: there was one storyline that didn't start until here. It really needed to start here. It was very easy to do. You just pull the storyline back, and you make because it was obvious to me in my head that that's what the final book should look like. It was even obvious to me, and I could see the interactions between that storyline and things in here, and I knew it. But for ease of my writing, I didn't start it until later. And then I said to my agent, I really cannot be bothered, and she said, look. The London Book Fair is right now. You can't be bothered now. If you want, we can hold off until the Frankfurt Book Fair. And I said, no, let's just go with it. Let's see if any of the publishers notice how easily it can be fixed. And one publisher did.
Yeah?
And he was the one I wanted to work with already, because I had met him once before, and I'd met him once. We spent 2 years before, my agent very shrewdly said, I think you should meet this guy, just have lunch with him. And I said, why? And also the publisher, we didn't send him anything, but he agreed for some bizarre reason. And we spoke for 3 hours about everything. And I knew that I should work with him. And I still don't know. I have to say, it's possible that my agent told him. I don't want to know. It's possible my agent said, Eric, you know, what you have to say to him is that the second, that major storyline has to come forward. Yeah. But I hope she didn't, because I have this fantasy that, you know.
I'd like to read a bit in a moment. But first, after we have to introduce the female character properly. Emily Hampton Wyvern.
Yes, Wyvern is fine. I deliberately chose a name that I'm not sure. You know, I'm not sure how it's pronounced.
Okay. Good. Emily.
There's a lot of comedy to do with pronunciation in this novel. Also, I chose a name. The word wyvern actually means a two-legged dragon, but because it's a heraldic symbol.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's the heraldic thing comes in. You know, it's very old English. But also, you can imagine that the name changes. It's one of the in English you have lots of names that are not spelled anything like they're written. And you can imagine, I mean, I can anyway, I can imagine wyvern might actually be pronounced wone.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and of course, you can't do that in a novel, right? You can't, unless you get a character telling you how it's pronounced. So it's a little, yeah.
But she changes everything in their friendship as well.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a classic triangle story of love, of course, in a sense.
Yeah, yeah.
And she changes also the relationship between these friends, and she is actually more or less faceless. We know that she's beautiful, but she's very ambitious, over-ambitious maybe. And we can understand why Zafar is in love with her and what he wants from her. I mean, he wants to belong to this part of England where he is by birth alienated from.
Exactly.
And now he gets this girl, it's his trophy wife, but he can never have her. And he's, for the whole book, he's waiting for her all the time.
Yeah, yeah,
he's
yeah.
just waiting, literally waiting. But on the other hand, what is her interest in him? Is it exotism? Is it jealousy? What is it that, why is it that she wants to be with him? Because that to me was unclear.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's funny you say that, because I had a male reader who wondered about that as well. And then the female readers all said, it's obvious. But it's very interesting. No, I mean, I don't know. I think that, you know, there's, in Graham Greene's The Quiet American, there's a question of what it is that Phuong, the female exotic Vietnamese woman, sees in Alden Pyle and the other fellow, I forget his name. And then there's the question of, you know, reciprocally. But I think the right way to understand what these parties see in each other, the right way is however the reader understands it. But one way is to apply a post-colonial lens, right? These are figures, these characters in this relationship, especially Zafra and Emily, you know, they are like Phuong and Alden. They are products of a particular kind of asymmetric history of power. Mm-hmm. And to me, it doesn't seem implausible that she would be attracted to him. After all, she's already, we know that she wants to do good in the world, yep, right? And here is this character who has earned his place in the world.
It's a private project.
What?
It's more of a project.
Yeah, and you know, she knows that much of her advantages are unearned, and I don't want to understate. You know, love is mysterious. Attraction is mysterious. Mm-hmm. This goes back to this business of looking at it without ego. You know, there are dimensions of it that are really uncomfortable, but they have the quality, if we're capable of being honest in the middle of the night with a whiskey in our hand and silence around us, you know, we're able to say, yeah, actually, there are certain things that I'm getting from this that feed the little boy, that nourished the little boy who was terrified of disappearing in Britain. You know, what she sees in him is you know, something like the washing away of sin. Mm-hmm. By association with him, she is cleansed.
Cleansed, yeah. Would you like to read a bit from this might give a little insight into their relationship. I marked it.
Where are you from? And where do you want me to read until?
I marked it up there. Oh, yeah, right somewhere there. Over there.
Okay.
It's of course, it has to do with the problem of, can you know one another?
Yeah.
Can parents know their children? Do they truly know who they are? Can lovers know each other?
Right.
Can friends know each other?
Yeah,
and
exactly.
The book is of course about how we're unable to know each other.
Yeah, exactly.
And this part I picked is also about that.
Well, this is a scene very near the end where Zafar and Emily, I won't be giving much away, are now in Pakistan. They've left Kabul, Afghanistan, and they're now in Islamabad. And Emily has appeared. Zafar left a little before Emily to arrive in Islamabad. Emily has appeared, has asked Zafar to marry her. So she has asked him. And all right. And so then Emily wants to go and find a vicar, a priest, an Anglican vicar. And Zafar is puzzled by this. Why, you know, but she has now entered the theater of the idea of getting married. And she wants to talk to a vicar. And then they'll go back to London. So there's an explanation of that. But so now they are in front of this vicar. This vicar is a Pakistani Christian vicar, and he is very puzzled. There's this guy who looks very much like me and Emily, right? So, and you know, what's going on here? And so the vicar says, Where are you from? We're British, said Emily. And you? He asked, turning to me. I was born in Bangladesh. Ah, Bangladeshi, I see. What is bringing you to Pakistan? I'm working in Afghanistan, said Emily. Oh, really? You have the work cut out. He chuckled. You wish to be married here? No, she replied. We'll be married in Italy. In Italy? He looked confused. Yes, my grandmother has a house there. Your grandmother? She is Italian? No. He looked even more confused. He then turned to me. What is your job? I'm a lawyer. Excellent. Apart from addressing the priest's curiosities, the conversation didn't seem to be going anywhere. I could hardly blame him. Two people outside his congregation appearing at his doorstep, asking for what exactly? When he seemed to have satisfied himself that he had his bearings, he asked Emily if he could see me alone. I'll wait outside, she replied. Perhaps I can look around the church. The door is unlocked, he said. When she left, the man turned to me and gave me a broad smile. I have to ask you this, and you can tell me the truth in confidence. Why do you want to marry her? I didn't know quite where to begin, and he must have seen that. Do you love her? Yes, I said. But he said, this love thing is a very tricky business, don't you agree? Again, I didn't know how to respond, and he did seem to want some kind of response, if only to let him progress along some route he had in mind. You must be honest. Are you marrying her for the passport? No. Are you quite sure about this? The devil always helps us deceive ourselves. I'm quite sure, I said. Where will you live? I don't know, I said, as I remembered a trite homily I'd read somewhere. A bird and a fish can fall in love, but where will they make a home? Unlikely, I thought. They only meet when the bird has the fish in its claws. Fall in love? I was holding back information, and I saw that if I left it too late, he would feel insulted that I hadn't shared it sooner. Perhaps I can help. I have a British passport. Oh, I see. He fell silent for a moment, lapping his tongue away as if gathering his thoughts. I think this lady is from a moneyed family. Am I right? They're well off. May I ask, are you from a moneyed family? No, I'm not. I see. Again, the pause and the lapping. Then you must think hard before taking this step. Very good.
It's terrible. It's painful. And I thought this scene was give great insight in the problematic relationship they have. And of course, it has everything to do with post-colonial. And I like your accent when you do that.
Yeah, yeah. I think I'm the only one who is allowed to use an accent like that. You can't do that.
Well, somewhere in the book you say that a language is only a dialect with an army and a fleet.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But in order to know someone, you seem to, anyway, the characters, they seem to like the method of eavesdropping in order to know someone.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of the Stasi, actually.
Yeah. And it's very sinister.
Yeah, and it reminded me also about the NSA. Imagine these immense piles of information of people who tell their most secret stories to each other. Mm. And no authors listening.
Yeah.
I'm very jealous of people who work at the NSA at the moment. Are you?
No.
No?
Because I'm not even convinced that they know people. But they certainly have, you know, information.
Yes.
But information isn't the same as, certainly not the same as knowledge. But there is a real... Yeah, there is always, we all stumble on this problem of you know, on this experience of a moment when someone we think knows us does something or says something, and it calls into question our confidence in their knowing
judgment,
of us, in their judgment of us, and you know, we try to repair it for them, you know, because it's deeply uncomfortable. And it's because we have, you know, it's this business, we have mental models of the people we know, and that's why we can be surprised by them or disappointed by them. We're not relearning people, and those mental, what's happening is everything is being compared to those mental models. You know, we were talking at supper about loneliness, and you know, I think a lot about loneliness, and you know, I think it's a fundamental human experience. It's an extraordinary thing. We have language, right? We have this.
But loneliness has a very negative connotation.
It has a very, yeah, and I mean it in the negative sense, though. I mean the existential loneliness, and yet, so it still surprises me that somehow language is not capable of eliminating or overcoming loneliness. It does. It's what we use. It's one of the things we use to try to overcome it, but it never quite works. You know, there's a shortfall.
I would imagine being in pain. It's impossible to find words for pain.
Yeah.
You cannot share the experience because the words are just the words. And you want to share the experience. You want to say, I'm suffering, but it's impossible. So suffering is also very lonely.
It's very, very lonely. No,
Okay. There are many, many things we have to discuss, but the time's running out.
Yeah,
There's a few questions left, and one is about you. Just in the novel, you say at a certain point that there are so many lives we drag along with us, so many unlived lives, and also so many novels that we haven't finished, which are in our drawers. And this book gave you a sense of fulfillment, of completeness in the end. I mean, this is not a bloody dagger, as you call it. This is a clean dagger. You finished it.
Did it give me a sense of... when I finished it, I felt that the book was finished, I mean, even before I did that revision, I understood what this book was trying to achieve. I felt that it had achieved that, you know. Remember, that sounds arrogant. Remember, I've been writing for 20 years, and I, you know, when you're in the zone, you're not thinking about how others think about the book. You're thinking about how you think about the book, right? But at the same time, I cried because, you know, a couple of things. I fell in love with the narrator, who's a really not a very nice person. You know, I became very attached to him. He's a flawed, fallen, sexist, you know, there's all sorts of flaws, but I actually became really attached to him, and I realized I wouldn't see him again, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, you cried. You had this physical, very strong reaction.
Oh, I cried. It was, and also, you know, I also cried for more prosaic reasons. You know, when you finish a book, I imagine all authors have that, you know, you realize then that the book had shaped your whole life. Every day, given shape to everything and meaning to everything. I used to go to sleep. I used to work pretty much all the time, even when I wasn't writing, because you know I'd wake up with all sorts of ideas. My sleep was inhabited by the work. So you know what this is like, and then so you realize.
Whenever I finish a book, I slap my wife, but this is also a good reaction. No, I kicked my car.
Really. Okay.
Which I really did, actually. Yeah. He said, why are you angry? I said, I've finished a novel. Okay, and we have to talk about, that's maybe one last topic which I really love, which is conspiracy.
Yeah.
I think the era after 9/11 is the era of conspiracy. Yeah. And you, in the light of what we know, you have a way with conspiracy yourself, which has to do with Afghanistan, the war in Afghanistan, and with Emily and Zafar, who actually don't know from each other what they are doing. It's very John le Carré-like. And it has to do with the plot as well. Yeah. What is your idea on conspiracy in general and in this book?
In general? Especially? Yeah, I don't.
I think conspiracy. It flourishes. I mean.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it? We love a good conspiracy story, and I. Yeah. I think conspiracy for me belongs to the same category.
And the key question in conspiracy is always where does the Jews come in?
Yeah, at some point,
it's always the Jews somewhere.
Well, it's not really a conspiracy until Chomsky is great on this. Chomsky, someone asked him a question about this famous the questions about how the towers. Apparently, the rate at which they fell is free fall, and if it wasn't, it couldn't be free fall if the towers, each floor fell like this and then like this, then it would be slower than free fall. So the claim is that there must have been bombs in the building to ruin. And Chomsky said, well, if the he doesn't need to address that because he says, look, if you look at the documentation, the American government really wanted a war with Iraq. This is back in 2001. That's what all the State Department and Defense Department, all the missives and communications, it's all about find me a way, Cheney saying, find me a way to go to war with Iraq. Now, at that point in time, right after 9/11, that would have been the best time. They had the pretext. They didn't do it. They didn't do it. And so you need to do a bit of investigation to see that actually everything was about Iraq before 9/11, right before. They were looking for an excuse to go in. And they didn't use 9/11 as an excuse. So for me, there's a plausible way of rejecting the conspiracy theories. But I think we have to be so... We have to be intelligent human beings and not try to find a way to reject a conspiracy theory. We have to say the conspiracy theory has to justify itself, right? And if it doesn't, then so reject it. But the conspiracy theory is the refuge of people without power. It's like the suicide bomb, you know? It's a way of telling a story.
It also replaces God, because everything is known. Everything has been... prefixed. It's like in religion.
Yeah, and it also feeds our appetite for story. We have this insatiable appetite for story. You know, this phrase, in English we have this phrase, suspension of disbelief. Well, actually, when you read a novel, you don't have to suspend your disbelief. Disbelief never enters the picture. You start reading, and you believe right from the beginning. Which is an extraordinary thing if you think about it. I mean, it's even more extraordinary in theater. These curtains open, right? And there are some empty chairs over there, and there are lights over there, and yet you believe what's going on inside that square. We are hungry for a story that has a certain kind of shape and meaning and makes sense. So I think, and gossip has someone told me yesterday, a friend of mine told me yesterday that she just spent the evening with a friend of hers who divorced her husband, the friend had divorced, and she said that her friend had said that the man had stopped paying the money for the child's education. Their son's education. He just stopped paying for it, right? And he was doing this out of spite. And I said, and my friend was very indignant about this, right? My friend was very indignant. She said that her friend's husband had stopped paying. And I said, sorry, who told you this? And, you know, it was a bitter divorce. And I think all of these things. When it's one of the things I explored in the light of what we know, epistemology. We should. I understand that in the baccalaureate in France, one of the courses is on epistemology. It seems to me, talking more about how we know things would be an antidote to our instinctive drive to believe things that have no merit.
Colonel Kurtz in Apocalypse Now, it's judgment that defeats us.
Yeah.
Oh, well, beautiful. I think it's time for a few questions from the audience. But first, maybe you want to read another little bit, if you have something available which you like or which you...
No, I'm... Well, sorry, I don't want to be difficult. I don't mind... Oh, hang on.
Yeah, you'll find something.
I can read this. I'll just read one paragraph. So it's a paragraph about one of the characters. So the narrator is trying to persuade Zaffa to stay. And he's doing this by... He's arguing that Zaffa should write. And he should write a book and stay. He knows that Zaffa's going to leave. So Zaffa responds. Eventually, Zaffa responds. And he's talking about... In a digression, he's talking about... the truth and metaphor. He's talking about metaphor. And there's only one paragraph. You know V.S. Naipaul's famous advice to the young Paul Theroux? You have to tell the truth. We think we know what he means, and in fact we probably do, but only because we know vaguely what Naipaul must think vaguely. He's saying more than merely that a novel is an experiment in life, which is what George Eliot said, after all, metaphorically, it isn't that at all. A metaphor is useful only for transforming what happens, enriching it in some way. It never tells you what actually happened, how it happened, or why it happened. A fleeting thought might be compared to a ship on the horizon, but surely it's saying something that a ship on the horizon is never compared to a fleeting thought. When a football manager, speaking about the range of talents in his team, says sagaciously that when you make wine, great wine, the very best wine, not all the grapes are the same, you know he is speaking metaphorically. Unless he happens to have a gig running a vineyard on the side. But what he is actually talking about, the right way to compose a football team, remains unproven, remains untouched by the metaphor. If metaphors increase our understanding, they do so only because they take us back to a familiar vantage, which is to say that a metaphor cannot bring anything nearer. Everything new is on the rim of our view, in the darkness, below the horizon, so that nothing new is visible but in the light of what we know.
It's time for your questions now. Okay. We have heel veel tijd, hoor ik net.
If I offended anybody with some of my comments, you know, do speak up.
Good evening. If we... let me think of how to ask this. If it's about this problem that we see immigration as a problem, and it's being solved by politicians that state that they know the answer. You say we don't really know the answer, and it's maybe not a problem because we shouldn't frame it as a problem. But how would the process then look like in your eyes? How would the problem-solving process then look like in your eyes when we talk about the immigration issues?
Yeah. Okay. Should we take one question at a time? Or
yeah, one question at a time.
The immigration problem is a different problem to different people, right? For some people, it's simply that they don't want immigrants. For others, the problem is how do we... what is the right number? And for others, the immigration problem is how do I persuade my fellow Brits to be more welcoming of immigrants? So it depends on, you know, what the problem is a different problem for different people. I want to make a comment only about a specific thing, and that is the problem of immigrants not feeling, not integrating. And that is, a problem in, you know, in some sense that I think a lot of people could agree. I'm not saying that immigrants should be integrating more. I'm saying that some immigrants are failing to integrate in a way that we would like to see them integrate. My comment about that is that it doesn't surprise me in the least, because certainly Britain is a very unwelcoming country. There's a lot of lip service paid to, you know, multiculturalism and all these other, you know, very nice things are said at appropriate times. But the reality, I mean, sometimes it's not even an appropriate time. If you imagine a politician says, whenever a politician says, not all Muslims are terrorists, how do you imagine an immigrant feels? So, but Europe has a real, it's very difficult for Europe. Europe is not an immigrant, it's not formed by immigrants. America is. America has, it's really easy for America to, you know, America doesn't have this immigrant problem.
At the Mexican border, you might call it an immigrant problem.
I'm talking about immigrants integrating.
Yeah.
That's why I had to draw the distinction with Croatia, what's happening. It's a very different things. But the presence of people in the country, and also that's actually really a Republican problem. Mm. It's not a problem for, you know, even Rudy Giuliani in the 90s, the rest of the Republican Party was condemning, was saying terrible things about immigrants in the South. Rudy Giuliani, a Republican mayor of New York, stood on the podium and he said to the nation, he said, if you're an illegal immigrant in America, come to New York. He said that. It's amazing. So it's a very different, you know, the mythology is different. There is no equivalent of the American dream here. You know, the idea of someone coming from overseas, starting with nothing, doing extremely well. This is a story in America that's, you know, I got an email 2 days ago from the president of City University of New York, a community college within this this university network. And she had written something in the Chronicle of Higher Education about my book, and she wanted me to see it. She sent it through my website. And I read the thing, and it said, she talked about how the students in her community college were from the same background as me, this sort of thing, and how the book had helped her understand what it was to bridge this class divide. And she wants me to speak there. This sort of thing doesn't happen in Britain. They don't care about there is no narrative of the immigrant coming in, making good and doing well in the society. It's not part of, there's no British dream. There's no, you know, it sounds absurd, right? Exactly. I mean, do British people dream? I don't know. So, suddenly I was Jewish there for a moment. So, yeah. But I don't know if that focuses my comments. I am writing something about it for, there's a wonderful, Bruno Kreisky was a post-war Viennese president, Austrian president, and in Vienna there's something called the Bruno Kreisky Forum, and we're working on a book about migration and belonging, really, and trying to say something new because, you know, there's so many people talking on this topic. But it seems to me this sense of belonging, really more and more, when I think about belonging, there isn't anything such as belonging. There's the absence of alienation. Alienation. People who belong don't go around thinking, "Hey, this is my, you know, this is where I belong." It's not a present feeling. It's the absence of alienation, and so that makes the job easier, really, because you need to look at people who are alienated and ask what it is, what it characterizes, what this feeling is. And I'm one of them. And it's not just to do with race. It's to do with class. You know, there are, you know, every young male who's white and, you know, turns to drugs or crime, burglary, you can talk to them about alienation as well, right? And in my case, you know, I didn't take up a gun. I took up a pen, you know. So I probably do more harm. But
but the same anger behind that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, my anger is not at people, it's at injustice. Mm. I tried to live it by being a human rights lawyer, but, you know, it wasn't quite enough. Sorry. Oh.
There's no question over there. Yannick, there. Oh, sorry, Darok, sorry.
I had a question about something you said earlier about when something is mathematically proven, then it can be unproven, and because it's not empirical. And I'm not a mathematician, so maybe it's a stupid question, but when it's, mathematics on itself isn't worth anything, right? It has no meaning unless a number is given some empirical thing. One is nothing unless it's something that has meaning to us. So I didn't really get that.
Yeah. We probably need to spend an hour before I understand your question. But that's okay. No, the best questions take, you know, you spend a lot of time trying to understand them because there's clearly something that you're grappling with. But no, numbers are, you could treat them as symbols on a page, and you have formal rules about how you manipulate those symbols, right? And so that's nothing in relation to number of objects. That's another way. So it's language as well. It could be. You can. And in fact, one of the people I mentioned, David Hilbert, you know, talked about it in those terms. He said, cause it, sometimes you can think of mathematics as just a very sophisticated chess game. And a chess game isn't saying anything about reality. It's not. It has no Platonic equivalence, right? It's not about the real world. And some mathematicians think of it in those terms, that it's very sophisticated. But most mathematicians don't. Most mathematicians think that it's Platonic, they have this yearning that it means something more than simply a sophisticated chess game. The reason I think of that is that we talked about God in the earlier on. God creeps in very many ways that God creeps in every time you start talking about human rights.
Yeah.
Because, you know, where is the basis for these things? At some point and the same with mathematics, you know, that there's a metaphysical dimension when you start asking questions about the reality of these things. I need three fingers to count three fingers, but if I write three in the symbol and I say that it acts with, you know, plus one in this way, then I just have a very sophisticated chess game, and I don't need to know if the chess piece is made of wood or marble. It's not important.
I find it very good, very good. Another question over there. I'm impressed, giving an answer to a question you don't understand. That's beautiful.
The way you speak about Britain, you actually sound a little bit angry. Zafar is in the book. And I wonder, are you objective or is it personal experience?
Nobody's because objective.
And
no.
Is it possible then to be objective? Because I can't really place it.
Yeah.
And for instance, what you say about America, welcome home, then I think, well, that is American, that's true. And they also very easily say, I love you.
Yeah.
But I don't believe them. And England has their own way. Maybe they don't communicate, but maybe they are also friendly. So are you objective or not? Then I wonder, actually.
I have yet to meet this fabled objective person. The idea of all we have are reasons. We certainly, you know, we might aspire to project the image of being objective, but in the end, we can't rely on. In assessing whether someone's objective, we have to look to the reasons for their argument. That's the only way, not to assess whether they're objective, but that's the only thing we should be doing, really, just assessing their argument rather than trying to find out whether they're objective, right? It's not necessary. It's actually irrelevant because for instance, if someone tells you that this this medicine will cure your disease, you don't need to know if they're objective. You don't need to know that. You need to look at their evidence. Yeah.
You sound emotional towards Britain.
Yeah.
And when I read the book, it was more the two characters.
Yeah.
But is it the emotion that comes through?
I see. No, I don't see what you mean. Sorry, go on.
Well, yeah, your opinion about Britain,
yeah,
it comes over very emotional, actually. So I'm wondering, yeah.
Well, I hope my feelings do come over as emotional.
Yes.
Sorry, I'm not meaning to be facetious. I'm sorry.
Emotions can be objective,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm not sure I know what... I thought that's why I ended up focusing on the objective point, because I didn't really understand what else is left if you take out...
Your emotion, yeah.
Yeah. I'm very emotional about a lot of things, yeah. No, that's true. I don't think that... anybody should take, give any weight to anything I say, other than insofar as I provide reasons for views. There's only so much I can do that in the context of an hour, right? But I'm not responsible for people giving weight to claims I make on the basis of the emotion behind them. I'm not responsible for how people make this. I mean, we talked about it before. I talked about how gossip and all these things. I mean, this is the infestation of irrationality that, it's got us into this. I mean, it's not an infestation. It's the crooked timber of humanity. We are prone to making these mistakes. We don't ask, how do you know what you just said? We don't ask that. And we don't care. I mean, you listen to the radio. There's this program called Any Questions on the radio in the UK. There's similar programs all throughout the world for politicians talking about the week's events, right? And you listen to the audience and they're clapping. And you know why they're clapping, because the guy has just said something that you already know that side believes. They're not clapping. They're not saying, oh, well, that was a fantastically well-argued point. They're clapping because they agree with him. I mean, that's the tragedy. That's the tragedy of democracy. We have people who are trying to find leaders who say things they agree with. That's how we decide our leaders. We don't decide them on the basis of, well, this person's arguments are the best. None of us do that. It's naive to imagine that we'll do that. Sorry, but that's the world that I would like to live in. Well, here's the thing. Right. Now, here's the thing. If it is pessimistic, does it make it untrue? No, I know. It might well be pessimistic. I haven't come to that. Right. No, I don't. That's not what I meant. But I can see how you might get there. No, I think there is hope, and that is in humility. Epistemic humility is the only way. I mean, the other day I heard that a Dutch town, the mayor had introduced the municipality had decided that to run an experiment, and half, it was to do with giving people a minimum living wage. Does anybody know what I'm talking about?
Where was that?
I thought, fantastic!
Where was that?
This is brilliant!
Eh?
What is brilliant about it is that they were running it as an experiment. They don't know. But they had some evidence. I read the article, the chap said, we'd done some research somewhere else, we'd read other people's research, and there's some evidence that this might work, but we don't know if it'd work here, but we'll try it. And that is what will save us, a sort of a humility about what we can and can't do. Every time I hear someone say, there's a problem presented, and someone say, we must do something, I'm reminded of, what is it? Was it Stalin, Culture, I reach for my gun. No, it may be that we should do nothing. But the idea that we just go in and do something, you know, that caused us so much, you know.
It's a quote from a German play from the 20s, actually.
Is it really? Yeah. Right, right. Yeah.
Okay, is there another question? Wait for the microphone just a second, please.
Well, currently I'm reading a biography about Mr. Vaclav Havel. And he wrote about a theme in his life was living in truth. So he was looking for truth, but truth wasn't to be found in some text or wasn't etched in stone, according to him, but it was like an imminent moving thing. And, well, the things you say makes me relate to that, actually. So how can you, on an aggregate level, because I sense a social worry and even anger, which you recognize that, how can you on an aggregate level reach the thing of living in a moving truth?
It's really, at the social level, it's a very great, there's, if you've ever watched a march, you know, there's always someone saying, what do we want? And someone, and the crowd says revolution, and then the person with the, you know, mega horn says, when do we want it? And the crowd says, now. And in my fantasy, I have, what do we want? And the crowd says, we're not sure. When do we want it? Well, we'll figure it out. Because it's a sort of, what I would like to see is everybody wants to say, every politician say it all the time, I want to see more honesty. I want to see epistemic humility. I want to say that, you know, and how you achieve
and
that.
And incompleteness. Again.
Incompleteness, absolutely. And I want to see more of that Dutch town, you know, that sort of thing. Because, you know, in so many parts of the world, you know, the idea of a politician standing up saying, we're not sure, is fatal for that politician's career. Hello? Yeah. Havel did, and I wouldn't presume to understand the nuances of what was happening in Czechoslovakia in that particular moment in time. And, you know, what it is in contraposition to something totalitarian, right?
Yeah, and he suffered personally. He suffered so hard that everything he said would have been accepted.
So, yeah. No, I mean, yeah, I mean, the great leaders of during periods of great change, Mandela as well, they advocate these utopian visions, and one can argue that those are tenable in those circumstances. I don't want to denigrate what they've done, of course not, but there's a specificity about them that, because it's certainly true that in Britain or in Holland, you know, someone's, maybe not so much in Holland, but certainly in Britain and in the United States, you know, a politician standing up and saying, well, it's a tricky question, this one, and we don't quite know where the balance is. What we'll do is we'll try it out in these states, this, and we'll try it. You know. It's incredible. It's fatal. So we have a public that has been trained to mistake conviction and certainty for wisdom.
Politician.
Well, there's a selection bias. You're really smart people. You know, I mean, you were, that's actually flattering me. Think about it. You're all really smart people. You know, No, what's happened, I think, in modern, I mean, I'm not an expert on politics, but there has been a diminishing of leadership, right? Leadership has gone in there. And you see that because also political parties are converging. You know, there's very little difference between Corbyn is the new leader of the opposition is an interesting phenomenon, but the party as a whole, the Labour Party as a whole, and the Tory Party are really not that far apart. And so leadership has disappeared. Leadership in the sense of creating a vision of a society and inviting people to come, urging people to come along with that. That's gone. It's more managerial. You see how politicians respond very with sensitive topics, politicians are quite slow to respond to events. They're quite slow. They need a sort of window of a few hours, and more it gets larger, to see how everybody else has responded. And over the years, I've noticed this window just becoming longer and longer. So they don't want to be, they don't want to lead.
There's another question over there. Oh, here as well, yeah. I think the last two questions, is that? three, sorry.
If I see you respond to questions, I see the process of your thinking. Does it ever happens that you, while trying to explain a question, you've got an idea what you want to answer, but that in the meanwhile you're coming up with the opposite of what you actually tried to explain? And if so, do you admit that to yourself, or do you hide it from myself? And do you have that?
I think I deceive myself very well, and I never come up with the opposite of what I intended. I could mean that seriously, right? I mean, we don't want to be uncomfortable, so we probably condition. But sometimes I do. Sometimes I certainly change my mind quite readily about lots of things. Very easily, I change my mind about lots of things.
There's such a beautiful little anecdote about Dutch names, you might not know them, about Leo Vrooman, who was interviewed by Wim Brands. And at a certain point in their conversation, Wim Brands says, "Ah, but you just said that." And Leo Vrooman, being a very old poet, said, "Ah, young man, that's such a long while ago."
Yeah. It's true.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, exactly. I do ask myself another thing. I find it a really useful exercise. And that is, when I have a view about something, I ask myself, what would I need to hear in order to change my mind?
That's a sophistical game.
Yeah. I ask myself, what would I need to hear? And what it actually does is it helps me focus on what it is that I'm relying on to form the view that I have formed. That's actually what it really ends up doing. But it's also, it's what Karl Popper argued, really, verifiability. It's essentially that. What would I need to hear? But it's imaginative. You have to say, and it requires a bit of work, but I find it really useful.
If you just follow the road of your thoughts, then you can come to nice places where you otherwise wouldn't have come.
Gentleman over here. Nasty meneer. Oh yeah, jullie waren samen, een vraag. That's mine. Yeah. Oh yeah.
He has the voice, he has the hands.
Yeah.
You talked about the importance of being rooted, and me being a psychologist, I always like to think about what makes a personality whole. You said that math wasn't enough. What would be enough?
Well, you know, adequate health care, loving parents, We're not that complicated. We can have. By the way, we'd still be screwed up. I'm not saying that we wouldn't be screwed up. I'm saying that we would be properly screwed up. And I think, I am an immigrant, right? And yet I don't see the predicament of the immigrant entirely through the lens of their immigration, of his or her immigration. They're a human being with all sorts of things that contribute to their well-being. And people need to feel. I, I don't want to get into a logical mess. People need to feel they belong, which really means people need not to feel alienated. Where are you now? Not feel alienated. And when the ambient society has so many signals day in, day out, and they're very subtle, that tell you that you're not part of this society, then, you know, I don't see how a human being can feel anything other than alienated. I don't see that.
But it already starts with the question, where are you from?
Yeah. It starts with where are you from.
It's a question. It's curiosity, but for you, it also stresses the fact of alienation.
Yeah.
So it's very difficult.
It's very difficult. I do think if you have a happy family life, that can prepare you better for the ways in which the world, your environment will try to alienate you, right? So I think, you know, that may be one thing. You know, if in your work, you know, if you get them young enough, if you know, that may be something to do. But I'm very pessimistic about. Because you can't change it. It's for me, more and more, I don't think it's a problem of these communities. I think it's a problem of the host. I think it's just a problem of the host. I'm not blaming the host. It's not, in a sense, you know, it's not your fault, or it's not. But it's really hard just to see it. It's hard for people to digest what's happened,
Is this a general view amongst migrants?
My friends and I, yeah. I mean, I had never had migrant friends, Bangladeshi or Pakistani friends, until quite late in life, in my late 20s, 30s. I didn't grow up in a neighborhood where they were, you know, where there were many South Asians. But I've made quite a few friends from those sorts of communities, and yeah, it's a fascinating conversation that doesn't seem to get represented in the press or the. It's fascinating, absolutely fascinating. I've wanted to write about that. I want to write a play actually, because you're talking about eavesdropping. Because I find myself eavesdropping on conversations in which I'm a party.
Yeah.
Right. are we really saying this? Yeah. Really? Wow. And I sort of think, wow, there's a drama here that people should hear. People should hear this incredible drama of, you know, just despair that it's not going to be, you know, it's very pessimistic.
I'd like to make a suggestion: write a novel about it and then turn it into a play. But first, we need a novel. Sorry. Okay. Last question, probably. Je wilt er helemaal naartoe, hè?
Most writers address one or two themes in a book, but you addressed so many topics. It makes it hard for the readers, but also for yourself. What drives you to do this, and how come you were so successful in this? To bring all this together.
Yeah. Successful in bringing it together. Oh, thank you. That's very, very nice. Well, I tell you what. It didn't feel like, you know, lots of different themes. It didn't feel like that to me because it was very clear. I'm writing a book now, and in which a character. It's to do with character. You to find what it is about this character that's important. What's important to this character, and in this case, her mental life. And then you see how, you know, then it just spreads. You then capture lots of things, and you see how they connect. And I don't see different things like maps and poetry. There's a discussion about the connection between them. I don't see things as unconnected. I see things as very, very, very connected. You know, there's a passage in which he talks about, religion, he has a spiritual side. This is Zafir, and he talks about the Nicene Creed and how he doesn't say, he would never be able to say, we believe, but he observes that in Eastern traditions they say the creed is rendered, I trust. And this is important because he's talking about this in the context of religion, he's having a conversation, but he's also talking about epistemology, because I and we, how can we know what others believe? But he's also talking about translation, right? And he's also talking about trust as opposed to belief. Why is that relevant? Because his prospective father-in-law later on says the two most important things in a marriage are respect and trust. And you just, you know, so you've got, and then trust appears in something else. Now, all this novel, everything, lots of things connect in many different ways. I like the text. When I write something, I like a paragraph to do work in at least two ways. It's a kind of lazy paragraph if it's working only in one way. It just feels lazy to me. And I like it to work in two different ways. And it makes for, you know, a second reading. I like going back to books and going, oh, wow, yeah. Sort of that, you know. So yeah. I don't know if that... I'm sure that doesn't answer your question.
Okay. That concludes... this evening. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, Zia, for your wonderful presence. You'll probably be book signing.
Yeah, so, there'll be signing.
Ligt een eens zo'n stapel, die moet echt weg. Oké, dank u wel.